Good afternoon, everyone. Happy Monday. Welcome to the start of another week and happy summer. First full day of summer today. Can you guys believe it? It seems like just a little bit ago, we were all talking about winter time, how cold everyone was, how much snow people are getting. And I don't know if you guys are still getting cold weather, if you gardeners from Canada or from the north, but let me know how the weather is doing in your area. We had a crazy heat wave last week, and it's a little bit cooler this week. I think today it's only supposed to get to like 80, 85, so it feels fabulous. All the shade cloth came off on Saturday. We actually had a graduation party for our daughter, Julianne. She graduated from college this year, so we had a party for her on Saturday. And between that and Father's Day, we didn't get our video filmed this weekend, but hopefully you guys were able to catch our videos last week. We did a couple of extra last week now that the book is done on putting up a sunflower trellis and something about the tomatoes. So anyway, I hope you guys had a great weekend. Happy Father's Day to everyone. Today we're going to be talking about some of the common problems that creep into your garden in the summertime and how to fix them. Because you've got your gardens planted, you started your seeds indoors, grew along with us with the spring garden series. A lot of you are doing things in containers, raised beds, in-ground gardens. But about now is when some of those crazy issues creep into your garden and we need to know how to fix them. Because a lot of times staying on top of them and helping prevent them before they get really bad is really the key to keeping your garden going, keeping the harvest coming, and making sure that things don't get out of hand. So thanks so much for joining. Let me say hello to those of you that are here in the chat. My phone tends to dim here in the bright sunlight, so I'm just gonna look down at my computer and take a look at the chat here. Thank you so much to everyone who's saying congrats to Jules. It was an awesome event, and she actually, it was for her whole film crew. They actually filmed a documentary that they put together, wrote, produced. She was the assistant producer, and we got to see a rough cut of it. So it was really, really an exciting evening, and really excited to congratulate her on her graduation. So let's see who's here. A lot of people are dealing with some issues. Cabbage and mustard worms from, that was from Perez, PBES 13. So yeah, that's a big issue for a lot of people. Dana is saying aphids. Huge issue for almost every gardener I know. Megan Ward, hi, how are you? Great to have you on here. I'm so happy that you're here. Ultimate Gardening, hello. Brittany, oh, yeah, we got some really nice petunias going. I have grown petunias a lot in past years, but I'm really falling in love with them this year. And they're surprisingly heat tolerant. I always kind of thought they were a little bit on the edge of heat tolerant, cold tolerant, but man, they're really holding up to the heat. So I'm very happy about that. I love the bright splashes of color. Hello, Kimmy Rose. Nice to see you here. Escape, Yvonne, Irene Moffitt is dealing with snails and slugs. Those can be crazy and extremely destructive in your garden for sure. Mind of Mandy is dealing with a white, fluffy, cotton-like, moldy-like fungus. We will be talking about that one today. I have a good idea of what that is. Let's see here. I know the Healing Berry is here watching us from Germany. She said it was still raining there, so hopefully things dry out. We're actually going to be talking about that today as well. So let's see here. Thanks so much for joining me guys today on a Monday. And we're going to jump into the very first problem that I think almost every single gardener in the world deals with, and that is weeds. So weeds are kind of the bane of every gardener's existence. I don't know of anyone who likes to weed, but if you do, please come on over to my garden and I would love to put you to work here. But weeds, especially now in the heat of the summer, they tend to just thrive. I mean, just like our vegetables are thriving in the heat with extra moisture, rain, humidity, whatever you have going on, so do the weeds. So a couple of things that you can do to help control the weeds. One of the biggest things I love to do, and it helps cut down tremendously on the weeds, and anyone can do this, is just mulch your garden beds. So you guys know I love to mulch with shredded leaves. I save all the leaves in the fall. I collect them when we have winds, and even, just different areas of my garden, even in the summertime where leaves might fall, or if we trim branches or whatever, I always save the leaves and put them into one of my big compost sacks. and then I just crunch them up with my hands once they get dry, or you can run them over with the lawnmower. And then I just spread a couple of inches over my garden bed. So that's great for heat, like we talked about last week. It's also amazing to help really suppress the weeds, because weeds tend to take over wherever there's bare soil. So whenever you can cover your soil and not leave it bare, it's going to help with so many different things. The heat, the weeds, just soil, water splashing up on your leaves to help with disease. So cover your soil with whatever you can. You can use pine needles, wood chips, straw, help suppress the weeds. And when weeds do pop through in my garden beds, because the mulch really keeps the soil from baking super hard, the weeds are very, very easy to pull out. So whenever you can, definitely mulch garden beds with whatever organic material you have laying around. Now, the other thing you can do, and I've done that in the Smart Pots Urban Raised bed right behind me, is plant intensively. And what that means is just plant, excuse me, I'm gonna scooch back just a little bit. Just plant your vegetables close together. A little bit closer than maybe, or you know, just, you don't need to leave tons of space necessarily between your vegetables. You don't want to plant them, you know, get them super, super crowded. But if you can plant them intensively, they'll kind of shade each other out and shade the soil out. And that will really help the weeds, because again, weeds tend to take over in bare soil. So anything you can do to shade the soil, cover the soil with lower plants, if you have taller plants growing in the background, that will definitely help the weeds from taking over, help suppress the weeds. And it's working great in this Smart Pots. This is the Smart Pots Urban Raised Bed, the 2x4 raised bed. And I don't think I've probably pulled a single weed out of there. I've got some tiny Tim tomatoes right here. And let me just hold up my my tripod here so you guys can get a good look. Tiny Tim tomato, some sunflowers, which are just about ready to bloom. I posted a picture on my Instagram this morning of these lovely little dwarf sunflowers. These are in my sunflower seed collection, and they're perfect around the edges of a raised bed. They only get to about 2 feet tall. So if you don't have a big, huge space for sunflowers, grab my sunflower seed collection, get some dwarf ones planted. And then I also have in here a pepper plant, an eggplant, and then a trellis in the back with some, the scarlet runner bean just popped up, or maybe it's a Kentucky pole bean, climbing up the trellis, and then some cucumbers. So definitely plant intensively will help a ton with weed suppression. And one last thing I have for you guys, you got to get all this stuff in your gardening tool belt. When you do have weeds pop up, and especially those stubborn weeds in walkways, this is one thing I've been using, and I'm going to be sharing some products with you today too, because you want to use those products that work and not waste your money on things that don't work. This is another Bonide product. I've been using a lot of Bonide products this year. Absolutely love them. They're very effective for organic gardening. This is called Deadweed Brew, and this is a concentrate. I think it might come in a ready to spray bottle as well, but you can add this to water, all the directions are on the back, and put it in a spray bottle and then spray it on your walkways. Of course, you want to be careful that you don't get it on your vegetables, because it's going to kill whatever it touches. So I've been using it mainly on my walkways to take out those stubborn grass and weeds that pop up in your walkways that don't want to go away. And sometimes you need a couple of applications, especially for really invasive weeds, but this stuff works great. So give it a try. There's a link in the video description if you're interested in grabbing some of that and helping get rid of your weeds. Okay, let's head back to the chat. I would love to hear what solutions you all have to get rid of weeds, and we can all learn from each other. I'm just gonna scooch my computer a little bit closer so I can see it better. Okay, here we go. And let me scroll down in the chat and see what's going on. Okay, let's see here. Here's a comment from Anne Brodzinski. My zucchini seeds keep rotting in the ground because of the rain. What's weird is the cheaper yellow early squash seeds aren't rotting as much. Oh my gosh, that's crazy. So yeah, the squash, the cucumber, the melons, sometimes they do tend to rot in the ground if they get a little bit too much moisture. So we are actually going to be talking a little bit later in the live stream on what to do if you get too much water, because that can be an issue for a lot of gardeners too, especially this year when we're getting tons and tons of rain. Okay, I'll never pull a bunch of weeds without gloves again. Yeah, they can be really hard on your hands, especially those really viney kind of weeds. And I do tend to wear garden, I didn't used to wear garden gloves, but I do a lot now because my hands are in the dirt so much and they were just getting so dry and cracked. So I do try and wear gloves whenever I can. So good, good tip. That way you don't get an allergic reaction if you have issues or allergies or something like that. Dana is saying, I've already taken, excuse me, 4 ripe tomatoes, all Caramello, but my others aren't far behind. So that is super exciting. Now's the time of the year when the harvests start rolling in. And it's so exciting to eat those first fresh harvests. And if you, especially if you've never grown tomatoes, if you're brand new to gardening, it is just so satisfying to be picking and eating your own fresh, tasty vegetables. Absolutely unbelievable. And here's my little Tiny Tim zucchini plant. It's in one of my Calichem 5-gallon smart pots. Tiny Tim tomato. I probably picked 100 little tomatoes off of it about a week ago, and this is a determinate variety. So the plant with a determinate variety starts to die after it produces its tomatoes, but these plants have an amazing life to them. I took some time, about an hour, I just sat out here and pruned my tomato plant. It was actually really relaxing. Gave it a good dose of another bug control, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. And it just started pumping out the tomatoes once again. So those harvests are super, super exciting. And I wanted to let you guys know that there is a special sale going on today just for live stream viewers. I'm not announcing it anywhere else, but because I really appreciate you all joining me week after week, Monday after Monday, I wanted to give you guys a special discount, a 20% discount, which I normally don't offer this time of the year, with the code HARVEST over at calichemgardeninghome.com. So head on over there, pick up all of your seed collections, your heat tolerant green collection. It's a great one to plant right now. The Tiny Tim tomato is in the container garden seed collection, and your containers, because your Calichem smart pots, because your garden beds might be full and you need to expand your growing space. So thank you guys so much. Appreciation to you. And I want to show it through that sale. So go over and grab your stuff, and the sale goes through tomorrow. So, okay, let's jump back to our second garden problem that so many people deal with this time of the year, and probably every gardener will deal with this issue this summer if you haven't already, and that is powdery mildew. And for the viewer who commented about that white kind of cottony substance, that's most likely powdery mildew. And I was trimming off some powdery mildew off my squash right behind me here. I don't know if I have any to show you guys. Oh, there's a little bit right here. So let me grab this little squash plant. See if you guys can see this. There's little teeny tiny white spots here on my squash leaf, and it's not bad yet. I'm glad I pruned this off, because you do want to prune powdery mildew off just as soon as you see it. If it gets bad, what it looks like is like a baby powder was shaken all over your leaf. So you want to control it. You really can't cure it, but you can keep it under control, especially if you detect it and take care of it right away, but you can also prevent it. So the number one thing for powdery mildew is make sure you're checking your garden daily, walking through your garden to see if there's any issues, and catch it before it gets out of hand. And it usually happens when you have times of high humidity. So those of you that live in very humid, rainy areas will especially be dealing with powdery mildew. So prune it as soon as you see it. But one thing I've been doing is really trying to spray preventatively. And something that's worked extremely well for me so far this year is copper fungicide. So this is another Bonide product, excellent, excellent product. This also works, works great to control powdery mildew, but you wanna spray it preventatively. So I spray down my squash plants here as soon as I planted them with copper fungicide. And then when it gets the time of year when powdery mildew comes in, If you're a seasoned gardener, you know about when that comes into your garden. You want to spray once a week. I believe that's what it says on the back of the instructions here. But follow the instructions. You don't want to spray it too terribly often, because too much, as with any spray, can be harmful to your plants. And always do a test spray first. So this is a great way to combat it. I've used milk and water combination in the past. Milk and water combination in the past, but this is proving to be a lot more effective for me this year. So grab yourself some of this. Again, link is in the video description, and let me know how things work for you. But you definitely want to prune it. I can't emphasize enough. Prune off any powdery mildew leaves just as soon as you see it. And you want to prune it as close to the main stem as possible. Squash leaves are hollow. You can see this right here, they're hollow. And sometimes when you leave an extra little piece of the hollow stem, bugs can get in there, more disease can get in there. But when you trim it close to the main stem, it's not hollow, it becomes solid, as close to the main stem as possible. And that way you can prevent powdery mildew from infecting, or a lot of other insects might climb up inside that hollow stem and do some damage to your plant. So hopefully with those little tips there, you guys, you can control and maintain the issue of powdery mildew in your garden. Another thing I've noticed this year, and I haven't sprayed them yet, getting powdery mildew, is my sunflower leaves. So I probably will go through this week and give all of them, because I've got a ton of sunflowers growing right now, give all of them a really nice good spray with a copper fungicide. But I have been trimming my sunflowers, the leaves that appear on those as well. So let me know here in the chat if you've been dealing with that already in your garden. A lot of times it happens to those older leaves, and a lot of times a little bit later in the summer, but we are getting a little bit early this year. Okay, let's see here. And of course you want your plants to last as long as possible. So by taking care of them up front here, you're gonna get lots and lots of squash, and help your plants to continue to grow and harvest off them as far into the season as you possibly can. Okay, let's see here. PJ is saying, hi Kim, I'm so excited about my Tiny Tim tomatoes. Thanks to you. They are just the most amazing little producer. And this one is by far, I think, the best producer I've ever had. Although, you guys, I meant to tell you, I lost a couple plants inside that just got infested with spider mites in spite of all my sprays and everything I did to save them. And I completely cut the Tiny Tim tomato inside. It was literally down to like an inch stem. Sprayed it again and to take care of the spider mites in the soil, and it has grown about a foot and a half now from the very tiny stem. So it is just an amazing little tomato. Absolutely love it. Okay, yes, thank you very much, Santa Ana Road Wildman. Never spray in heat. You always want to spray on a cloudy day, early in the morning, late in the evening. You don't want to spray in heat, because that can burn your plant's leaves. The only thing you want to spray in heat is weeds. So when you're spraying that dead weed brew, you want to spray it in the bright sunlight for maximum effectiveness. What this basically does is dries up the weeds and gets down to the roots. So you definitely want to spray this in bright sun and not when there's a lot of moisture. You're expecting rain or anything like that. And I see we just got a super chat from Environmental Coffee House. Thank you so much. How kind of you. And the comment is here, you are a wonderful teacher. I am now going from a traditional raised bed garden with no sides to fabric gardens in the front of my house. That's awesome. I love the fabric raised beds. They are such an effective way to go, and so, so easy, you guys, to pop up. This raised bed back here by Smart Pots, I think it's around $50 for a 2x4 raised bed, so the price is right. You can grab those over at smartpots.com, and you just pop them up, fill them with soil, and you've got a garden. So you really can't get any easier. So Environmental Coffee House, thank you so much. I really appreciate the super chat, and I'm so happy that your raised bed garden, your fabric gardens, are doing really well. Okay, thank you so much, PB. Z13, you take the fear out of gardening. It's amazing once you start simple and you start with a few simple skills. Don't get yourself overwhelmed. Don't feel like you have to plant tons and tons of vegetables. Then it's amazing how it just does take the fear out. You're successful and you just want to keep growing more and more. And I talk about that a ton in my book. So if you don't have this, grab it for that 20% off. You can get a signed copy from my website, calikimgardeninghome.com. You will absolutely love it. Okay, let's see here. Highly Blessed 23 likes watching the harvest videos. Don't forget those. We absolutely won't. We just wrapped my second book, the photos and the manuscript, a couple of weeks ago. So we're definitely going to be pumping out more videos. In fact, little sneak peek here, we're hoping to have a harvest video out in the next couple of days. So definitely stay tuned for that on our channel. Okay, Pessy says, what big pot do you need for zucchini? Love from Israel. Okay, I like to use at least a 10-gallon smart pot for zucchini. I have one growing right around the corner here in a 10-gallon. And it really is a 5-gallon, like my Calicum smart pots are really way too small for a zucchini plant. They are big plants, but you can grow it vertically. Just put a tomato cage over it, feed the leaves up through the cage as it grows, and it's gonna help you save a ton of space. So head over to smartpots.com and grab one of those 10 gallons. They now come in beautiful colors. You're gonna absolutely love that color pop in your garden. Okay, let's see here. Do you pick your pepper flowers if your peppers are still small and producing flowers? You know what, Anne? That is really an individual choice. I've done that some years and some years I haven't. And honestly, I haven't seen a ton of difference. So, you know, what you might want to do is try it to one plant, experiment with one, and then, you know, leave another plant alone. Don't worry about pinching the flowers. See if you notice a difference and then go with whichever one, you know, works best for you. So great question. Soledad, what's your favorite vegetable to grow? That is such a hard question for me to answer. Probably tomatoes. I love tomatoes. I'm growing so many different varieties this year. Maybe we'll have to do a tomato tour. I mean, it's a lot of different varieties for my garden. I know some of you that have humongous gardens, you might have like 40, you know, varieties growing. I might have maybe 15, I'm not sure, which is a lot for me. Sometimes they do well, sometimes don't. I'm always struggling with shade in my garden, so it really just depends on, I try and plant them in full sun, but it just depends on if the tree grows that's next to it or whatever, so we're always kind of battling that. But yeah, I'd have to say tomatoes, although the blackberries are, it's gonna be a really good blackberry crop this year, and I'm super excited about that as well. So great question. Okay, third issue, and a very common problem that a lot of gardeners have, I'd say almost every gardener. If you haven't had this problem, you're very lucky. And that is the problem of aphids. Now, aphids are a teeny tiny little bug that multiply extremely quickly. And what they do, in fact, I just saw some aphids on this squash plant. Oh, there's some powdery mildew there too, not good. I'm gonna go ahead and pick this flower here from the squash plant. This is a male flower, but I've got a good amount of them on here. So I think we're okay to pick this one. Can you guys see those little teeny tiny green bugs on this flower? Those are aphids. Now, if I didn't take care of this plant, and we'll have to do that tonight when the sun goes down, these would multiply so quickly and just really take over and infest probably this entire little raised bed behind me here. So what they do is they suck the sap out of the plants. They suck all the juices out of the plant stems and leaves, and eventually will be very detrimental to your plant's health. So what you want to do for aphids is, number one, like I said earlier, check your garden daily and take care of the issue before it gets out of control. What I tend to do when I see aphids is immediately grab the hose and just give my plant a quick spray with water. Now, normally you want to keep the leaves of your plants dry. We always talk about that to avoid powdery mildew, diseases, etc. But you know what? There's always pros and cons to any situation. And I would much rather, you know, spray off my my leaves, spray out the aphids off my leaves or any other bugs, then have them taken over and have a bug infestation. So do it in the morning before the sun comes up, so it gives your leaves a chance to dry during the day. And hopefully that really does take care and knock them off. However, you wanna keep doing that, you know, for a couple of days. And if that doesn't work, a couple sprays I have used, or one main spray I've used this summer that works great is, let me find it here. And this one works very fast. Again, an organic spray for organic gardening is another Bonide product. It's insecticidal super soap. The thing about this is, you guys, you can use this for a lot of different insects in the garden. And I've used neem oil, the peppermint rosemary oil combination in the past. That works great too, but it doesn't work quite as fast. You've got to reapply that every 3 days or so. This works very, very fast. again, organic. And I believe, I didn't realize this, but it can also be used to control powdery mildew once it does show up on your plants. Now, I haven't tried that yet, but I definitely will be trying that. But I used it a few weeks ago to spray an aphid infestation on some eggplant, and it worked really, really well. So give this a go, you guys. Aphids are probably one of the worst issues that most gardeners battle with. So this stuff works really, really well. And hopefully by using that, you can help your plants last much longer and have a lot more veggies to harvest. So let's jump back into the chat, see what questions you have and comments you have about aphids. They literally are probably the bane of most gardeners' existence. Okay, here, yes, you do need that Super Soap Santa Ana Road Wild Man. It is a fantastic product. Okay, here, I see here people talking about ladybugs. I did try ladybugs will eat aphids. So that's a great beneficial insect to have in your garden. I did try ladybug release. It's been many, many years. We did a video on it probably shortly after we started our YouTube channel, and the ladybugs just flew away. And I have never tried it since then, but hopefully some of you that have had success with that. It just hasn't worked for me in the past and I haven't tried it again. So that's also a good solution, is to try some beneficial insects that will eat the ladybugs. That's always a good thing to do. But be aware that you are paying good money for those ladybugs, and it's pretty disappointing when they fly away and are nowhere to be found the very next day. So anyway, just a little FYI. Okay, let's see here. There's all kinds of different ladybugs. That spray again is called Insecticidal Super Soap. And all the links for the products are in the video description. And by the way, you guys, I do get a lot of comments and questions about where do you get this product or that product, things I use in my videos. I always put the links in the video description because I want to make it easy for you guys. I want you to be able to use things that actually work and not waste your money. You know, we're all on tight budgets and we want to make sure that we're not just, you know, spraying our money down the drain on things that don't work. But again, do a test spray on a small little, you know, leaf on your plant. Don't spray your entire garden down or even your entire plant down. If there's damage, you may want to wait till like a cooler day. You don't want to spray in the heat. And then, you know, just wait and don't spray that particular vegetable. But you don't want to damage your entire plant before you test it out a little bit first. Okay, here. I just saw a question about Kellogg's Breakfast from Irene. Do Kellogg's Breakfast tomato plants bloom again after first harvest? Yes, they do. They're an indeterminate plant, which means they're going to continue producing until the frost takes your plant out. So I've actually got a Kellogg's Breakfast right in front of me here. It's got a nice big tomato on it, several blossoms on it, and we're hoping to get a good harvest off of that this year. An absolutely amazing tomato, right up there with Golden Jubilee. They're both kind of similar. Did a video on Golden Jubilees last week. They're both a beautiful orange sweet tomato and really delicious. Okay, let's scroll down in the chat here and let's see. I don't see any other questions at the moment, so we're going to go into our problem number four that a lot of gardeners deal with during the summer, especially if you live in California, but I think a lot of people are dealing with this, and that is too little water or drought. We are in a crazy drought here in California, the worst year ever for drought. So it's going to take, you know, we're going to have to water our gardens very consistently or they're just going to burn up in the heat. Obviously, too little water can kill your plants. And what happens when plants get too little water? They get stressed out and they're responding to the stress and they're not able to just keep on producing the vegetables. So you definitely want to be aware of when your plants are not getting watered consistently, especially in containers, you guys. It's very easy to let your containers or hanging baskets dry out quickly. Sometimes during a heat wave, they need watered once, even twice a day. Last week, are my hanging baskets, I believe I did water them. The ones that aren't on drip, I watered them probably twice a day. They were completely dry in 100 degree heat. A lot of times what I'll do is I'll just take the hanging baskets down and move them into the shade, and that definitely does help. But what you want to do if you do not have a drip irrigation system and you live in a drought area is definitely install one. Highly recommended. They're relatively inexpensive. You can get a raised bed kit at Home Depot or on Amazon for around $35, depending on, you know, your area, of course. They're easy to install. A lot of you might be intimidated if you've never done it. I was too when I first started. I had no idea what I was doing, but we dug in there and we did it. Once you get in there and do it, you'll be amazed at how easy it is, and you'll wonder why you never did it before. It gets the water to the roots of the plant. A slow drip at the roots of the plant saves water, saves time. And the biggest thing is your plants get watered consistently, which is really the key to, you know, helping your vegetables pump out those delicious harvests all season long. So highly recommended. If you can't do that and you live in a drought area, get out early in the morning and water your plants the best you can. Maybe you have a balcony with no access to a hose, bib or anything like that. Become an early morning person and get out in the morning and make sure that you check your containers and make sure that they're very thoroughly watered. One thing, I think I mentioned this last week, that you can do for your containers so that you don't have to water quite as often is put them in a tub or a bin of water. Let the soil get saturated and get soaked up with water, and then take the container out of the tub of water, and you'll be amazed at how much longer you can go in between watering. So definitely extremely important. Also critical is mulch. So I mentioned on last week's live stream, I mulched my entire garden, even more mulch before the heat wave, and I was really surprised at how the soil stayed very moist underneath that mulch, especially during the hot weather. So extremely important to get out there, get your drip installed, and to mulch your garden and your containers too, and your hanging baskets if you live in an area with too little water. So we do have several videos on watering. Watering your garden to beat the heat is one of them. How to install drip irrigation in containers, and then how to water containers. All those videos have a lot more details on helping you beat the heat and beat the water shortage in your garden. So let me hear from you guys in the chat. Any suggestions, comments, questions on beating the water shortage in your garden? A lot of people dealing with aphids here. Can wood chips and shavings be used as mulch from Miriam? Yes, they can. Wood chips are a great source of mulch. You do not want to mix them into your soil. When you plant, you would just kind of pull the wood chips back. Mixing them into your soil can rob your soil of nitrogen, but they're a great source of mulch, as well as shavings like the straw shavings or the animal bedding types of situations that you might see at your local feed store. Straw is a great source of mulch. There's lots of things out there that you can use. So just do whatever fits into your budget or what you have for free in your own backyard. Okay, I love to use pine needles also, Constanzi, when I can get my hands on them. They are a little bit heavier. They don't blow away as easily. So they're also a very good source. Hindi360, how are you doing? And you're asking, will your plants recover from heat stress? It really just depends. Sometimes they will, sometimes they won't. It probably depends on how long they were left to dry out, how much stress they underwent. Container plants have a little bit more difficult time recovering from heat stress because, you know, they just dry out quickly, and before you know it, they can be really droopy and wilting. So no guarantees on that one, but do the best you can to keep them watered and keep them happy. Okay, Lily Woody is saying, only my tomatoes, mini watermelon, and peppers are thriving in the desert big heat. Will likely start outside 2 weeks earlier for all others. Still have kale and cabbage alive plus dill. Wow, it's amazing that you have kale or cabbage alive and dill, because those are normally cool weather vegetables. So you must be doing something right. Hopefully you're using shade cloth and able to keep those shaded and going in the heat. But it's a good thing you have that kale planted. That's a great heat tolerant green. And that is absolutely a wonderful thing to grow in the heat. So go back and watch our video we did a couple weeks ago on the summer salad station. So very glad to hear that. Question from John Samuel, how you doing? When do you plant pumpkins so they will be ready in October? You know what? I haven't grown pumpkins for many, many years. Cliff is the one that can answer that. He's a giant pumpkin grower. I would imagine depending on the location where you live, you do have to get them planted. And also depending on the type of pumpkin you're growing, small ones will be ready to harvest sooner. Larger size pumpkins will take probably 90 to 120 days. So Cliff, let me know if I'm right on that. So you're gonna have to back that up from the time that you want to harvest them in the fall and even get seeds going indoors, to get them going even sooner. Okay, vermiculite is a godsend. Let's see, I just missed the comment there. Probably to help with water retention, I would imagine, in your container soil. And will the insecticidal soap kill squash bugs as well? Question from Kay. You know what, that's a good point. It says it will kill over 30 listed insects. I haven't looked particularly on the label to see if it will kill squash bugs, but go over to bonide.com and check it out. They have the label that you can look up on the back to see what types of bugs it will kill. And they have a great little tool over there called the Garden Problem Solver. And you can click on that and type in the issue that you're having in your garden, and it will pull up ways to help you solve that problem. Different diseases that you might have going on, different bugs you might have going on, and we'll offer you a product to help, you know, match those two up so you can help solve your garden problem. So really, really good resource over there, because sometimes you have no idea what's going to work and what's not. Okay, start pumpkins very soon if you want it by Halloween, says Cliff. So Cliff's the man on that one, so make sure you do get them going. Okay, let's see here. Santa Ana Road Wildman, really good question. I believe he asks, will super soap work only if sprayed on the insects, or will it act as a barrier? I'd have to look that up for sure. I believe it is for use on the insects themselves. If you want to use something that will work on the insects that will chew your leaves, you might want to use neem oil. So that works really well if the insects aren't present when you spray, because when they chew the leaves and suck the sap out of your plant, they ingest that and then it kills them. So you may want to have kind of a two-pronged approach with that one. Okay, we're going to cover here our last common garden problem, and a lot of people are dealing with this as well, and that is too much water. There's tons of extreme weather conditions going on all over the world right now with climate change and all that sort of thing, from the drought here in California to tons of rain. I know, like I mentioned, the healing berry in Germany, tons of rain this year. A lot of you on the East Coast, tons of rain, tons of humidity. In Texas, tons of rain, right, you guys? Louisiana, aren't you guys battling a tropical storm right now? So crazy, crazy, crazy. So the rain can just leach the nutrients right out of the soil, especially in your containers, but also in your raised beds and your in-ground garden. The plants kind of look kind of sickly and yellow. They're just waterlogged. They're getting basically drowning in the water and getting really nutrient starved. So that's, I think, even more of a difficult issue to deal with than the drought. Because with the drought, at least you can water. But with tons of rain, it's happening all over your garden. So that's very difficult to handle. What you will want to do, if at all possible, to let your raised beds dry out a little bit, or your garden dry out a little bit, is cover things if you can. Pop up a couple of patio umbrellas around your garden to protect, you know, from all the excess moisture. Maybe you can put some stakes in the ground and put a little canopy over it. You want to try and find something breathable, though. I wouldn't recommend using plastic or anything like that, because your plants will boil underneath that. But give maybe your special plants or your special garden beds a couple of days with that to let it dry out a little bit. You probably won't be able to do that all summer, because then you won't get sun, but I would maybe do that in between rainstorms to kind of let things dry out. And then make sure that you're not overwatering. When things happen to our plants, what we tend to do, if they look yellow or whatever, we tend to rush out and give them water. So if you live in an area where rain is not an issue, make sure that you're not overwatering your plants. Always check your soil. Stick your finger in the soil. If it's wet, you don't need to water. If it's dry, you do need to water. So it's going to be different watering situations for everyone out there. But super important, again, that you wander around your garden and check your garden daily. So too much water is definitely a big issue that a lot of people face, and it can be just as destructive to your garden as not enough water. So do make sure that you're paying attention to that. Okay, let me see. Oh, another thing I wanted to mention is make sure that you are adding some extra organic matter to your soil to help your soil drain well. So good drainage is super important. And what you can do if you have your own compost is mix some of that compost in, mix some shredded leaves into your soil. The Vermistera worm castings are also a great soil amendment to add aeration and make your soil nice and fluffy. In my garden here, we have heavy clay soil, so I'm constantly trying to add things in to aerate that soil, because a little bit of extra water in my soil just gets very hard packed and clay-like. excuse me. So the more that you can aerate, the better your soil is going to drain. So definitely give that a go as well. Okay, so those are the main five garden problems and issues that I have for you today. I know there's tons of other issues out there, but those are probably the ones that most people are dealing with. So hopefully those tips were super helpful to help you solve those issues. And now we have a little bit of time. I'm going to jump back into the chat, answer your questions, and see what's going on in your neck of the woods with your garden. Okay, Ron M. asks, can you fertilize during a heat wave? We actually talked about this on last week's live stream, Ron, so you may want to go back and catch the replay of that. I try not to fertilize during a heat wave because what that does is it stimulates new growth, and you want to save all of your plant's resources during a heat wave just to keep in that plant alive. So I would really wait till after the heat wave, if at all possible. If you are in an area where you get constant heat all summer long, what you may want to do is just fertilize, you know, at the beginning of the plant's life when you first plant it. And then, you know, try and do it in the morning, definitely when it's cooler out. I love to use the Vermistera worm tea because it's a very mild fertilizer. It helps, you know, kind of give that your plant the boost it needs to keep on going, but it gives you your plant a slow and steady growth. So you don't get that huge, huge burst that will, you know, stress a plant out in the heat wave. So if you don't have that, make sure you grab some and give that a go. Okay, let's see here. Irene has a question about watermelon. They're about a foot long, about Charleston gray watermelon, and first time growing them. How much do I water them? Okay, watermelon do need a lot of water. They're mostly comprised of water, hence the name watermelon. So you do want to make sure that you're not letting them dry out, keeping your soil consistently moist. But again, there's no magic bullet answer when it comes to how much should I water them. You water them when they need it. So it might change for you, Irene, based on the temperatures, on, you know, where you live. It might change based on the type of soil that you're using. So, you know, you'll get it down, a little bit of trial and error, and you'll get it down, but do make sure you're checking them daily and keeping that soil consistently moist. They do like a lot of water, especially in containers. Don't let your melons dry out in containers. Okay, where do you get your worm castings from? PEBZ13. I use a worm castings called Vermistera. I've used them for many, many years. You'll find a link in the video description. You can grab them for 10% off with the code CALIKIM, and they are a great soil amendment for your garden. So make sure that you are using those. It really works well. Okay. Question, Kim, if I plant, from John Samuel, if I plant carrots now, will the heat keep them from coming up? Okay, John, carrots are a cool weather vegetable. They thrive in temperatures under 80 degrees. So during the heat, you're not gonna have the best chance of them growing. And if you wanna keep things simple and really help your garden thrive, you wanna plant cool weather vegetables when it's under 80 degrees, and warm weather vegetables when it's between, say, 60 and 90 degrees. And full explanation of that in my book. So John, I have a feeling you need a copy of my book and grab one today, and all the info is in here to help you out, okay? All right, Nicole says, I miss the CALIKIM coffee walks. Thank you so much, Nicole, that's so nice of you. I'm hoping to do a few more of those now that my book is finished. And that's my favorite time of the day to just, you know, grab my coffee early in the morning and walk around. So be looking for one of those very soon. I've had a few people mention that they missed those. So thanks a lot, Nicole. Appreciate the feedback on that one. Okay, let's see here. And my screen is freezing. Okay, here we go here. Yeah, I don't know if I can get to any of the brand new comments. Might have been my internet. Oh, no. Okay, here we go. Okay, let's see here. I'm going to scroll back and answer some comments I didn't get to earlier in the live stream since my current comments are not showing up. Okay, here's a comment from Barb. I had shredded leaves around my contender green beans, but the pill bugs were eating the seedlings. Purchase Sluggo Plus to stop them. Good idea, Barb. I have used Sluggo Plus in the past. And I'm scrolling back through. Did I see camera guy is here? I'm not sure if I saw him here in the chat or not. I've used Sluggo Plus in the past as well. That product does work great against the slugs and the snails. The Bug and Slug Killer by Bonide is also a great product. I've used that with my strawberries. And I know Santa Ana Road Wildman said he's used that with really good success too. So try some products and use what works best for you, definitely. Okay, here. Scrolling, doing a walk through the garden daily definitely helps me catch my garden issues from Yvonne. Yeah, it's a great way not only to catch any issues that might be coming up, but it's also extremely therapeutic. And there's so many different rewards to gardening that go way beyond the fresh vegetables, although those are amazing as well. But just walking out through your garden and seeing, you know, the beauty that you've been able to grow and plant around you is just so extremely satisfying. So definitely couldn't agree with you more on that. Thank you so much, Nicole. Don't forget to give Calikim your thumbs up. Really appreciate that. And scrolling back through here, diatomaceous earth is also a good product that you can use for the creepy crawly insects. Lots of earwigs in the garden, lots of issues going on in the garden. So yeah, I don't really see any more questions here. It's maybe my internet is having an issue here. Let me see if I can refresh real quick and get back on. Yeah, it says I'm offline. We actually upgraded our internet this morning, believe it or not, and wouldn't you know it, it's not working. At least on my computer and my phone, I just can't see. It's dimmed probably because of the heat here outside. Oh, here we go, we're back online. Let me see if I can get to the chat. Bear with me, guys, for just a moment here. We have a few more minutes and we can answer a couple more questions. Okay, oh, here's, yes, looks like I am back online here. Okay, comment from Anne Brzezinski. I wonder if shade cloth would benefit late planted carrots. It definitely wouldn't hurt. What I found is that the shade cloth keeps your vegetables underneath about 10 to 15 degrees cooler than the outside temperature. So, you know, give it a go, definitely wouldn't hurt. All you've got to lose is the price of a couple of seeds. You know, what I would do if you're planting late carrots is plant them in a container. The carrots do enjoy the loose soil. I've had a lot more success, like in a Calikim 5-gallon smart pots. I think I had them in a 20-gallon smart pots 1 year. I've had a lot more success in containers with carrots than I've had in my in-ground gardens, because, you know, in your in-ground gardens, you might run into roots or rocks. And they don't like the obstructions. They tend to grow nice and straight in containers when the soil is nice and loose, or in your raised beds, because you're filling raised beds with your own either DIY soil or nice loose soil. So give that a go if you want to get some carrots planted. Okay, let's do one more question before we sign off for the day here. Thank you very much, Santa Ana Road Wildman. Great to have you on here. I know you're usually working on Monday, so really glad that you're here. And let's see, someone, I just saw a question here. It was asking about pole beans or bush beans. I can't, oh, there goes my umbrella. Ah, almost fell over on my giant tomato cliff. So I'm so lucky that it didn't hit that container. Okay, you know what? It really depends on what type of trellis structure you have. Pole beans and the runner beans, like I have right over here, I really need to be on a larger type of trellis. The bush beans are a great vegetable to plant this time of the year because they grow so fast. And you could be harvesting those in about 6 to 8 weeks in warm weather. What was I gonna say about that? Oh yeah, now is also actually a great time to get a new wave of veggies going. So you wanna grab my late summer garden seed collection. It has the Tiny Tim, it has some beans, it has, I think, some greens and some small little zinnia flowers. And that way you have a new, and some cucumbers. That way you have a new fresh wave of veggies growing to pop in when you get diseases on some of your vegetables. Oh, it also has one of these little bush scallop squash, which are so amazingly delicious and beautiful. But that way you have a new fresh wave of veggies growing to plant later in the summer. And if you have plants that die from powdery mildew or diseases, you'll have new vegetables to take their place. So beans are a perfect vegetable to do for that. And I'm going to hold on to my other umbrella so it doesn't fall over. The wind, a little breeze kicked up. So anyway, yeah, great idea to get beans growing, and you'll be harvesting them within 6 to 8 weeks, or have vegetables to pop in as your other vegetables die off in the late summer. Well, guys, I'm going to go ahead and sign off for today. Thank you so much for joining me. It's been a great live stream, a great time in the chat. Make sure you do grab your special live stream 20% off for today and tomorrow with the code HARVEST over at calikimgardeninghome.com. And we look forward to seeing you on next week's live stream. And I almost forgot, there's no live stream on July 5th. Which I can't believe. I think that's in 2 weeks. So it's a crazy thought that we're already talking 4th of July. All right, you guys, have a great week. We'll see you later. Bye-bye.